Hello, I'm John Furrier with theCUBE here in Seattle, Washington for a preview of AWS reInvent, also getting all the latest updates here from Amazon Web Services. Eswar, Bala is here. He is the Director of Container Engineering at AWS. Eswar, thanks for coming on theCUBE. Good to see you. You get the hottest area, containers, is the cloud native keys to the kingdom.
Right.
So you got the AI world connecting in with cloud native. Mm-hmm. What does that mean in your mind? How do you see the cloud native world, which has been leveling up and now bringing all the greatness of the cloud? KubeCon just happened. The Cube was there, seeing a lot more innovation.
Yeah.
Kubernetes is getting boring. That's mm-hmm. a good thing.
Yep.
Just like Linux is boring, it's very reliable. Everyone
right.
uses it.
Right.
Containers still are super important in the development process.
Correct. John, first, thanks for having me, and thanks for visiting us here in Seattle. So let's talk about containers native first, right? So we heard cloud native. What we believe is containers native is it's an application-centric view of what we want to do for developers. And containers native is all about enabling developers taking an idea to production with minimal effort. And that, like if you think about where effort's getting spent today, mm-hmm. it's all in, it's not just the business applications, but it's also setting up the infrastructure, right? Like, so scaling, right? And security and compliance, all of these things. And what if we enabled all of this into our container services, folks, allowing developers to focus on their applications? That's the view we are taking here in AWS. And if you talk to the engineering teams, they tell us that 70% of their time is actually spent on their infrastructure management. Only 30% is spent on the business applications, right? Mm. And that's the problem that we want to go tackle. And we've made several strides into that story. And there's a reason why 65% of net new AWS customers come to AWS ECS. And EKS, if you think about EKS, customers, sophisticated customers using EKS, run tens of millions of clusters annually on that, right? So now, what are we doing there? So first, I want to highlight the stuff that's happening in ECS, right? The first one is Amazon ECS Express Mode. What we are planning to do is with a single click and a container, customer is going to take it and get to a production application with just a single click. We manage infrastructure, we manage domains, we manage networking. And we launched Amazon ECS Managed Instances, which is all about giving the infrastructure flexibility to customers, but providing a Fargate-like experience where we take on operations for patching, scaling, mm-hmm. security, all of that is handled by us. And most importantly, we are launching something for Kubernetes customers, and we are calling it Amazon EKS Capabilities. And it's three features that I want to highlight. The first one is allowing customers to take their codes committed into Git to deploying into Kubernetes clusters very easily. So we are announcing managed Argo CD from the community. So the second thing we are doing is customers can actually manage their AWS resources using Kubernetes APIs. So that's ACK for you, AWS controllers for Kubernetes, and we are managing it for customers. And finally, we are announcing managed Crow, which is Kubernetes resource orchestrator, allowing customers to compose really complex resources from primitives. And we are going to manage that for customers. Like with that, customers would be able to define, this is what my web application looks like. They can templatize it and standardize it across their orgs. And now every developer in the org can actually take it and run it, right? So they don't have to worry about what does the web service mean for their organization.
So unifying, it's a unification between Kubernetes and AWS.
That's precisely right.
And so on the news, what's available? Can you talk about what's announcements? Will there be previews? What's GA? Is it GA?
Yeah, so the EKS capabilities we are launching in December at reInvent, and it's going to be GA at launch. Everything that I mentioned, ECS Express Mode, is launching today, mm-hmm. and that's GA already.
And the terms of the Kubernetes ecosystem,
yeah.
do you see that growing, and how do you see that evolving? Because that is has been a key growth vector for
right.
containers,
right.
and then orchestrating across.
Correct. And we're clearly seeing the shift in containers, customers using containers for AI in the Kubernetes ecosystem.
In which way?
For example, customers run sophisticated agentic workloads on Kubernetes. They run multimodal inference on Kubernetes. And they also run GPU-intensive batch workloads on Kubernetes, right? All of these put together drive a really strong agentic AI story for our customers. And to put this growth into perspective, there are 2x more than GPU instances, weekly GPU instances managed by Kubernetes in AWS compared to last year, right? Like that is the staggering amount of growth that we are seeing on AWS. And if you think about the, like I want to highlight three key areas that we are investing in this space, right? So the first one is we want to focus on infrastructure automation for AI workloads. And that's where EKS Auto Mode comes into the picture. So EKS Auto Mode handles the GPU provisioning, picking up the right instance for your workloads, right-sizing the workload for the instance, and making sure that the scaling all happens automatically and really fast. So that's our first story. The second one is we are focused on operational, large-scale operations as well. For example, we announced 100,000 node EKS Ultra clusters for Kubernetes customers. We see foundational model builders using that feature. We see lots of inference working, like running on these 100,000 node clusters, for example. And most importantly, we are also focused on operational intelligence. So we are announcing integration with Amazon Q in both ECS and EKS. So what that allows developers to do, using Q, they can troubleshoot their operational events in a matter of hours or even minutes instead of days that they end up spending their run books, collecting information, and synthesizing them together.
So they got the AI to help them there and Q help them there.
That's exactly.
Talk about the things that you create that's the undifferentiated heavy lifting, because in containers there's a lot of things that are involved that you got to manage, observability data,
correct. Mission
queue. Right. What is the big lift with the container native approach? What does that do for the infrastructure, DevOps engineer or developer?
Correct. The first thing we want to do is the infrastructure automation piece, right? Like, so that's a place we've focused on very heavily over the last 5 years. Think about the launches we have done on the ECS side. Fargate was our first foray into that, like where customers don't have to worry about managing infrastructure. We have actually translated that into EKS Auto Mode, and we've translated that to ECS managed instances as well, for example, right? And if you think about the AI side of the equation, we also announced hosted MCP server support for customers. Customers preferring to use their own tooling to troubleshoot issues can now use the MCP servers to get the cluster context data and make really good intelligent decisions. Because these are hosted, customers don't have to download. They get automatic updates because it's running on our site, right? Mm-hmm. And they get all the benefits that we on our site are evolving from into these MCP servers.
On the roles of the containers, and I mean obviously DevOps and infrastructure automation,
right.
The consequences for not getting it right are significant. When you're looking at compute, you mentioned GPU.
Yeah.
What are some of the things that you see that are super important to get right? Because you're dealing with now resources on workflow, tokens are involved,
right.
A lot of these workloads.
Right.
This GPU underutilization has been a big topic.
That's right.
At supercomputing recently. And so people want to maximize their throughput.
Mm-hmm.
They want to maximize their budget.
Mm-hmm.
How do containers fit in there? Because most people think, oh, containers is for developers and workloads. But now you've got consequences because you want performance.
Yep. Yep. So containers is a very natural fit. If you think about the problems in that space, it comes down to, hey, how do I pick the right instance type or GPU type for my workload, right? How do I right size it, right? Number two, how do I make sure that I can scale in and out really fast, for example, the dynamic nature of the system? And most importantly, how do I utilize, how do I drive the utilization up, like what you're saying, right? And the ways we see customers approaching this problem is, they try to amortize the GPU fleet across different kinds of workloads. It could be training and inference running in the same environment, for example, or inference and batch workloads running in the same environment, right? For which the system needs to be really dynamic in moving workloads around and fitting them where it makes sense. That's exactly Carpenter and EKS Auto Mode is designed for, right? And we are seeing several GPU AI workloads running on EKS Auto Mode today because of that particular aspect.
Just a personal question I want to ask you because, it's fun to watch the cloud native from day one. The Cube was there when CNCF was formed with KubeCon, before even part of Linux Foundation.
Yeah.
Watching it mature, the role of containers has changed. Share your point of view on how mission critical containers are. You just highlighted a few examples where, I mean, the consequences of getting that wrong are you can quantify them and they're not good.
Yeah.
You're talking about compute resources, you're talking about GPU, we're talking about real performance.
Right.
How far along has containers come? Share your thoughts on the importance of the role of containers in this big picture AI world.
Right. Let's talk about the community first, right? I think containers has been entirely driven by the cloud native community at the end of the day. Yes, we do have ECS, and we have actually driven our own unique way for our AWS customers. But if you look at the community angle, lots of the orchestration capabilities we got right? Like we had an application-centric view, right? And that naturally translates into AI workloads as well, right? And we didn't land up here with all these features. It took us over 10 years to evolve the system, right? Like when Kubernetes launched, it had nothing but support for web services at the end of the day, right? Like stateless services. It went through an evolution of stateful services. It went through an evolution to effectively use GPUs, right? Like so dynamic resource allocation in Kubernetes. So it has taken all of these learnings and implementing it into the community and to be here at the right place where many foundational model builders now use Kubernetes to run their workloads, for example, right?
And I would say that the AI workloads would fail if Kubernetes ecosystem wasn't as mature through that open infrastructure wave.
Yeah, it definitely is a big enabler for the AI.
What's next? What has to happen next? Okay, this is happening, container native.
Yeah.
We're seeing the AI stacks emerge around the models.
Right.
You know, model-driven approaches. But still, the infrastructure is expanding.
Correct.
What has to happen next?
So, I think the next step, obviously, is, we have all of these models. And we are expecting many customers writing applications that leverage this model, right? Now, if you think about what do you need in this world where it's not GPU applications, it's still general purpose compute applications, but they are using the models. So we need to make sure that orchestrating that easily spinning up the model and connecting into the application is one aspect. Mm-hmm. The second aspect is if you think about the agentic application model, you're gonna have lots of agents working in tandem to achieve a result at the end of the day. Mm-hmm. And you want to run these agents in really sandboxed, isolated environments, right? There's a question on, is containers the right boundary for those workloads? Or do we have to come up with a better isolation model with strict virtualization built in so that way we can protect the cross-tenant approaches?
And if you look at some of the things that's coming out at reInvent, some of the trends, security, runtime.
Right.
You know, the agents have a runtime.
That's right.
I mean, everything kind of rhymes,
right?
It's kind of coming together.
That's right.
You know, remember, generative AI is just generative process is a runtime.
Yep.
So it all kinds of comes together. Well, great to have you on. Appreciate it. We'll see you at reInvent. Congratulations on the news. Obviously, we're going to ship this on after the news is out, but thanks for coming on. Appreciate it.
Thank you so much, John.
All right. Containers, again, continuing to provide the value for the developers and now the infrastructure automation, again, in a perfect lineup with the AI infrastructure. I'm with theCUBE. John Furrier, your host. Thanks for watching.